All right. Well, welcome to today's webinar. My name is Stephanie Weber, and I'm the Assistant Director of Programs here at National Center for Women and Information Technology, NCWIT for short. And today we are so happy to have you here to talk about the DoD STEM Ambassadors. But first, a little bit about NCWIT. If you don't know about our organization, we're a nonprofit community founded in 2004 from an NSF grant. And our mission is to convene, equip, and unite change leader organizations to increase the meaningful and influential participation of all women, no matter their intersection in the field of computing, in particular with innovation and development in computing technology and STEM more broadly. And we are really pleased today to bring you information about the DoD STEM Ambassador Program. So a little bit about the, oh, before I get to that, thank you. Wanted to let you know that your feedback is extremely important to us. And at the end of the webinar today, we will be asking you to fill out a really quick survey about your experience at the webinar today, what you learned, and provide us any feedback. You will also hear from our evaluator, who also will send a separate link. So thanks in advance for helping us make this all better. And we wouldn't be here today without the DoD STEM. The Department of Defense STEM is a consortium of partners and a resource for you all to learn about opportunities about STEM, careers, engaging videos, and other types of educational resources that are available. I would highly recommend checking out the website at dodstem.us. It will also be added to the chat for all different types of resources that you can use in your classroom and also personally. And with that, one of the resources that you will find on the site is the DoD STEM Ambassador Program. And today we have Eric Moore from the TGR Foundation, who helps run the DoD STEM Ambassador Program, who will tell us more about that specific program. So Eric, handing it off to you.
Thank you, Stephanie. Really excited to be here and to speak to you all about the DoD STEM Ambassador Program. Just very quickly about TGR Foundation, we're a national program that provides STEM educational enrichment and professional development for teachers. And for the past handful of years, we've been managing and facilitating the DoD STEM Ambassador Program. It's near and dear to my heart. It's one of my favorite things that we get to do to really work with a cohort of teachers every single year, some of the best educators around the country, to be quite frank, to help support them and empower them to improve STEM outreach and access. So the DoD STEM Ambassador Program started in 2020, and it's part of the Defense STEM Education Consortium. And so we're now in our fourth year of the program, and we're up to, I think, about 78 teachers so far. And you'll be hearing from one of them shortly, Darren Gray, who's part of this year's cohort. But so the Ambassador Program is really grounded in what we call the DSEC fundamentals, which, you know, if you've seen the federal STEM report, they have some federal STEM goals. And so a lot of the work that we do is aligned to those STEM goals. And it's really about increasing kind of STEM outreach and access and to improve the pipeline of students that are taking STEM courses and going towards STEM careers. So like I said, it's a yearly cohort of exceptional K-16 STEM educators. So they really do run the entire range. We have elementary educators this year. We have like Darren himself, we have educators up in higher education and everywhere in between. The program, broadly speaking, provides funding, support, training, and resources to bring those high quality STEM learning experiences to students, to promote DoD STEM opportunities and access. And a big component of the program is really helping teachers understand what the world of DoD STEM looks like and all the partners involved and all the programs involved and the resources. And it really is quite overwhelming. So we try to help distill that down. And as ambassadors, ask them to share that wealth, share the information. One of the big things I'm a big believer in is it's recognizing and empower STEM educators. So those folks are on the ground doing really good work and really leveraging. I've mentioned DSEC a couple times now, but it really is a network of partners, NCWIT being one of them, TGR Foundation being another one, to really amplify all the work that we're doing across the country so that we're working together towards common shared goals. If you want to learn more about the Ambassador Program, you can see the link there to check out the yearly cohorts of teachers. On the next slide, you're going to see a map. This is my not to scale, poorly done map, but of folks. This is, you'll see the 4 years of folks. This year is our biggest cohort yet. We have 26 teachers from across the country. They range anywhere from, you'll see a cluster of folks. It's a little hard to see, but you see a cluster of folks in the Southern California area. We have folks in all the way to DMV area and everywhere in between. We do have some gaps. I mean, the Midwest, I think, needs some love, if I'm being honest, but we're still growing the program over time. And then every year we have more and more educators, which is great. And you'll see the one on the right there, we had an educator from high school teacher from Germany, taught at a DoD as well in Germany, and he's part of last year's cohort. So we continue to grow. And on the next slide, you're gonna see some details around what the program's all about. Okay, so essentially the kind of four broad components, professional development, which is focused on domains prioritized in that federal STEM strategic plan. So things like computational literacy, inquiry-based and transdisciplinary learning, domains that are, I'm doing poor job explaining, but there are a variety of domains in the federal STEM strategic plan that we highlight. All the ambassadors are required to present at a regional or national conference and really to kind of help spread the word of DoD STEM and then the programs and resources that are available. Some people like Darren here has been to many conferences this year. Each ambassador also puts together a blog post that's featured on the DoD STEM website. And then each ambassador also works on what we call an impact project, which is kind of taking the totality of what we do and having an impact that can sustain over time. You can see there also the award funding. So it is $12,500 $12,500 stipend for your time. There's some money for STEM supplies to help get some supplies for your classroom, and then some funding to attend and register for conferences and to join together for our annual DoD STEM Ambassador convening. You see an image there. Back in February, we brought the entire cohort to Washington, D.C., and that was actually a tour of the Naval Surface Warfare Center out at Hard Rock. It was a really cool tour of the work that they do, the DoD STEM professionals in the flesh, and kind of all the amazing things that they do. So in terms of a time commitment, so this is a yearly program. We meet monthly as a community of practice, is on a Saturday. So we take up part of your weekend for 3 hours. We do have that 2-day convening each program year. And then typically about 6 to 7 hours per month of additional work, right? So either in support of your sponsoring organization, which in this case might be NCWIT, or in support of some deliverables and components that we ask you to do. So all told, it's about 10 hours per month of anticipated work, but that can certainly fluctuate because like the months of December and January tend to be a bit lower than other months, right? So some months there may be quite a bit of time commitment. So you're attending conferences and that sort of thing, and other months might be a bit drier. So, but averaging out, it's about 10 hours per month throughout the entire year. So anyways, that's just kind of a snapshot of what the program is, who's involved, and what we try to do with our time together. And with that, I think I'm going to hand it back to Stephanie.
Thank you so much, Eric. I really appreciate that overview. And just a reminder for those who are attending, if you have any questions, feel free to put them into the chat. And we will have a Q&A session towards the end of our program where you can ask questions to both Eric and Darren, as well as myself from NCWIT. And so with that, it's a great honor to introduce Darren Gray. Darren is our NCWIT DoD STEM Ambassador for this year. And I've been honored to work with him over the last several months on his projects and his presentations and just getting to know him and his work. So with that, I will give it to you, Darren.
Thank you. So hi, I'm Darren Gray. Before I get into my role as an ambassador, I just want to give you a little background about me. There's me in the center circle. That's a young Darren Gray in a home ec class in high school. And I grew up in the city of Detroit. And this was during the late 70s, early 80s, when I was in high school. And at the time, the city of Detroit was undergoing a tremendous upheaval. The auto industry had collapsed in the late 70s. And so there were not a lot of opportunities for employment. You had a lot of things that were going on in the city. And so I had things pulling at me in different directions. So in the top there, you see the initials YBI. Well, YBI was one of the first gangs that became criminally organized in Detroit, and they attracted young African-American males to sell drugs, because at the time there were no laws that really punished, you know, people under the age of 18. And so this created this entire thing that we see now today. And in a city where, you know, most families had lost their primary source of income, it became an attractive way for people to support. And so, you know, growing up in the inner city of Detroit, there was a lot of draw to that, you know, being poor and then seeing other people, you know, making a lot of money. There was definitely a pull in that direction. In the center on the left, that is my high school counselor. After my freshman year, I went to my high school counselor to talk about, you know, my career goals. I had all A's and a C in typing. And she told me, that's actually her picture. She told me that I really didn't have what it takes for college and I should consider going to a trade school. Now, mind you, the only class I got a C in was the trade class. But she had decided that I wasn't, National Honor Society. And so that was the last time that I had I didn't go to a college counselor again. Until my senior year. And because of that, I didn't know what the SAT was. I did not know a lot of things. Quick, funny story. When I was applying for colleges, schools of engineering, I kept getting letters of inquiry from a school called the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. And in Detroit, there was the Lawrence Institute of Technology, which was a tech school at the time. I think it's a for-profit school now, but it was a tech school. So I never opened the Massachusetts Institute of Technology letters. When I got to USC, you know, we were all sitting around bragging about who recruited us and everything. And people were talking about MIT. I said, well, I never heard from MIT. And so, you know, and then people were talking and somebody said Massachusetts Institute of Technology. And I said, oh, yeah, I heard from them. And people laughed at me because I did not know that was MIT. Fortunately, because I ended up where I should be at USC, but I was heavily recruited by MIT, but I never opened a letter because, again, I never went back to my college counselor, because clearly she had some issues with, in those days we called it tracking, where the kids of color were sent to vocational school and the white kids were sent to on the college prep track. So I became my own college prep. And then there was, you know, lots of gun violence at the time, you know, violence that affected, you know, our family as well. So those were all the things that were pulling me in the bad direction. Now to the right, these are all the positive influences. At the top, there is Cheryl Gordon. She was a senior in my high school, and she was the one who told me what an engineer was. That got me involved in the Detroit area pre-college engineering program. My mom is there. The person who introduced me to DAPSEP is there at the bottom. And that line shows what the unemployment lines were looking like in Detroit. Next slide. And I say that to say that programs that the DoD STEM program supports are what turned that possible path for me going down the wrong path into the person that I am today. So I'm passionately an advocate for STEM outreach and the work that DoD STEM does and NCWIT does, because it personally affected my life. And without programs such as that, I could have gone in a bunch of different directions that would not have placed me where I am today. Next slide. So as Eric said, we get a chance to present at conferences. So I presented at the Science for All Summit. And one of the great things about the the requirement to present at some of the conferences, you also learn a lot by being in those conferences. You learn a lot about what other people are doing around the country. I had stopped going to conferences years ago because as I've gotten a little long in the tooth, I became the person who knew the most. And so I wasn't learning anything anymore. But, you know, Eric and his team challenged all of us to, you know, go out and present and share what we know, because it's time for us to not only share our practices, but also to help bring that next generation of outstanding people in STEM so that we can continue the work that most of us have done forever. So at the Science for All Summit, I presented on engaging Black students in STEM. And had a lot of participation. It was a great time. But something that also I gained at the Science for All Summit was something that I learned that I didn't know before, which is that for people with disabilities between the ages of 25 and 65, there's an 80% unemployment rate. And so that impacts what we do in the STEM field, because we are leaving behind a whole population who can positively contribute to what we do in the STEM field. Next slide. The other one I got to present was at the SITE conference, the Society for Information Technology and Teacher Education, and a very similar topic, the addressing the inequities for Black students because of the digital use divide. Now, the digital divide we talked about a lot in the early 2000s because there was not a whole lot of access to computers for communities of color. But then came the smartphone, and people at that point decided that the digital divide was solved because we can easily get, you know, smartphones in people's hands and have access to the internet and have free Wi-Fi. But there's something called the digital use divide, which is teaching people how to use technology in a way that benefits their life, whether it's education or banking or finance or job search, as opposed to what a lot of young people use it for now, which is social media, entertainment. And so the digital use divide is clear when you look across communities where the emphasis on technology is more for consumerism and content, content generation for likes and clicks, as well as for entertainment, as opposed to using it for understanding how the world works and using it to improve people's experience in life. And so it was a opportunity to share that, and a number of my colleagues, they didn't even understand. They thought that we had solved the digital divide, but in sharing the digital use divide, then the light came on for a lot of the attendees. Now, something I learned at the SITE conference in attending another, and again, one of the great things about being an ambassador is you get to meet other people from around the country, is I went to an AI seminar, and one of the researchers presented a findings. They created a paragraph just to generate, they actually used a ChatGPT to create a high school student paragraph. And they ran it through the AI, and they told the AI the first time that the student was from an inner city school and another student was from an affluent school. And the same text, the AI scored the student from the affluent school higher than the student from the inner city school, exact same text. And so she said, okay, maybe I triggered the AI with the words affluent inner city. So she said, okay, let's just be straight, Black and white. The AI scored the white student higher than the Black student. And then she says, okay, all right, well, let's try this. Listens to classical music versus listens to rap music. Again, the AI scored the student listening to classic music higher than the student listening to rap music. Again, it's the exact same text, exact same AI, but because it was given this background information. And so one of the things that I learned about SITE is I knew about the biases in AI. I did not know how nefarious they were, because this was something that she would not have known had she not used those testing parameters. And now we're using AI to evaluate students for entry into college. We're using AI for health informatics. We're using AI for job searches. We're using AI for resource allocation in cities. And so if there are inherent biases underneath it, it's something that we can, that's something that we need to do something about. And so again, I really enjoyed presenting, but I also learned a lot. All right, next slide, please. I'm a vice chair of the LA STEM ecosystem, and one of the things that the DoD STEM ambassadors really want is they want for us to make connections with our local STEM community and share the resources. And so as vice chair, I took the liberty of taking over a presentation and presenting about the DoD STEM. And a lot of my colleagues, there are 75 organizations that are involved, had never heard of DoD STEM and didn't know of the resources that were there. And so almost all of the folks here in Los Angeles were able to use it in some way to either share information or share resources with their students. Next slide. My next conference, I'll be presenting at the American Society of Engineering Education about women underrepresented in STEM, and really talking about how the recent data shows that there are more women undergraduates in college than there are men. But in the computing world, it's like 80-20. And we need to do something about it by finding out what is going on and what are the obstacles? What are the things that are preventing women from participating in coding and in computer science? And so that is what the presentation, and NCWIT has given me a lot of resources into being able to share information. Now, it won't be a presentation lecturing, you know, all of the deans on what they are doing wrong. It won't be anything like that. It'll be sharing resources as to how to make sure that your class is more inclusive, how to make sure that when you are out in the community, you are engaging girls and young ladies in ways that make it easy for them to participate. Quick story, my own daughter, went to school 15 years ago. And her first semester, she was a computer science major. And she said, "This is for the birds." And she changed her major to psychology. I could not get her to go back into computer science. Now, mind you, she is technologically proficient in ways beyond most people. Like every job she has, she's the IT person and the tech person. Whenever I have some project, I just give it to her and tell her to do it. And you know, I jokingly tell her that, you know, you could have replaced me years ago, but in her mind, at the time when she was taking computer science, all males, extraordinarily boring, with just, you know, she thought it was going to be something else. She just was, you know, writing code for hours. She's like, "This is not something I want to do. I can't imagine myself doing that." So she is, she majored in psychology and works at the County of Los Angeles doing outreach in the mental health department. But she is probably one of the most gifted in the STEM fields of the people. And I don't say that just because she's my daughter, but she is. And people have said that. And it was funny because when she was growing up, people would say, "Hey, you're going to be just like your dad." And she would say, "I'm going to be better than my dad." So next slide. One of the things that I did, my blog post for, it hasn't been blogged out yet, but I wrote a blog regarding the new ABCs of a connected world. And I got a chance to present this at the House of Code. I got a chance to present a speech on the House of Code at Congress a couple of weeks back. And it talks about the role, the risks that we get from AI, biotech, and cyberspace, and the opportunities that are there for students. And so hopefully the blog post will be out and it'll be shared across both the DoD STEM as well as NCWIT. So you have to stay tuned for that, unless you can find a recording of me and giving the presentation in Washington, D.C. Next slide, please. So, you know, there's me presenting at the House of Code. The other benefits of being a DoD STEM ambassador, you see me and my friends, they're actually behind us. I'm blurred, but those are my friends who hang out with me and go out and share STEM. Those are my robots that travel with me whenever I go places to talk about STEM and get kids inside it. And they're not just demo robots. You can actually program them. And it also helped to shed light on the inequities in the STEM world. So being able to talk to people about the STEM inequities. When I was, you know, Darren Gray, you know, director of the STEM this and vice chair of that, people go, yeah. When I say, "Well, you know, I'm a DoD ambassador, STEM ambassador," then people go, "Whoa." So having the DoD STEM ambassador title really makes a difference. When I was in DC for the convening, one of our donors from USC offered to host me, and we had somewhat of a Jeffersonian dinner where I was holding court on the the opportunities for STEM for kids of color with Congress people and other higher ups in government and in industry, where people they wanted to know, you know, from the DoD STEM ambassador. So it in addition to, you know, the credentials that I have being a part of DoD STEM, it lets people know what it is that we're trying to do. And then lastly, you know, in that slide on the right, it's really giving opportunities for students with disabilities. This weekend, we're hosting an activity here on campus for students with disabilities. STEM, it's a STEM day for students with disability. We partner with the Aerospace Corporation and JPL, and we are kicking off our new focus on inclusion by having this event. Now, the University of Southern California, as with most universities, are very accommodating. You know, we provide accommodations for anyone. If a student says, hey, I'm in a wheelchair, we will make sure that student has an opportunity. If a student says that, you know, I am, you know, I have trouble with hearing or I have trouble with sight, we make all sorts of accommodations. But we put the impetus on the student. Why don't we do this from the beginning? Why don't we start thinking about how to be inclusive and not just accommodating? If you've ever had to drag a heavy cart full of anything across any long distance, you will see the trouble where there are no ramps, or where the ramp is on one side of the building and the elevator is on the other side of the building. So I've had to drag heavy carts of robots all across long distances, and there are places where cars will block ramps. So we need to rethink inclusion and not just accommodation. And that's really what we're trying to do. And not just by having a one-day event for students with disabilities, but to make sure that every event we have the ASL interpreter, we have the closed captioning, we have the Spanish translation, because we have a predominantly Spanish population out here in Southern California. But everything that we can do so that students, when they say, hey, the STEM Center is putting on an activity, the kids that typically would be like, well, you know, it's not for me, will be like, oh yeah, that's that place that does the inclusive work. Next slide, please. So part of my role over the last 30 some odd years has been really being a STEM evangelist, talking about why we need to get kids of color involved in STEM and why STEM is important. And I've been sharing that across, you know, the country, sharing that with a bunch of people and really sharing, but most of the conversations have been about diversity, equity, inclusion, fairness, and making sure that there are opportunities. Now, it's a matter of national security. I've had conversations with people from all of those organizations who have told me that if we don't get more kids to go into STEM, our country is in danger, because whatever that next innovation is, whoever gets it wins. When you start thinking about quantum computing, whoever gets that wins, because with quantum computing, cybersecurity is nothing. All of the innovations is nothing. AI is nothing when you have that quantum level computing. When you think about all of the major innovations that have happened in the last 200 years in the industrial age, it pretty much came from the United States. You know, we are the leaders. However, that's no longer the case. When you look at what happened in Congress, and I'm not taking a side on the TikTok ban, but TikTok is not a product created here in the United States, and it has a significant influence on information that young people are digesting. My daughter is in her 30s, and she gets most of her news from TikTok because she doesn't trust mainstream media. And so whatever that next innovation is will set the course for the next 100 years. And something I like to share with folks is Great Britain ruled the roost from the Spanish Armada to World War II. They were the dominant superpower until they weren't. And if we want the United States to continue in its economic and military, in terms of our defense capabilities, we need this next generation to be the ones to take that leadership role. And when I have all of these different agencies contacting me personally, I'm not talking about sending, you know, emails. I'm talking about people actually calling me or Zooming me saying, hey, you know, what are you doing to, you know, like it's my role to take on the whole country. But really having those conversations and sharing the importance of it. One of the things that you can get away from when you start having the conversations about DEI and the arguments about it, you can just say, you know, it's in the interest of national security to have as many people at the table as possible in order for us to continue in our excellence. I was in a meeting yesterday with one of our partner groups, the Hidden Genius Project, which focuses on African-American males. And there was they had a debate on the if Gen Z should be in control. And I said to them, if I take out your power grid, you're not as smart as me. Yeah, you're smart as me with your AI and your TikTok and your YouTube. But if I hack the power grid, you can't beat me. And then they said, oh, how would we learn? And so it's important for us, those of us who are a little bit long in the tooth, to get more kids involved in the creation and the generation of new ideas, not just the use and consumption of them. Thank you.
Wow, thank you, Darren. I really appreciate that. That was a great presentation. I encourage those that are here to submit some questions in the chat, but I also have some that were submitted earlier for both Eric and Darren. So I'll start with a few of those, but again, for those that you are attending, we'd also want to hear from you, any questions that you have for either of our speakers today. First for Darren, can you clarify? So this is, and you know, like to hear Eric's thoughts on this too. This is the DoD STEM, so the Department of Defense STEM Ambassador Program. You know, often people hear Department of Defense and they assume you have to be in the military, that you need to be enlisted. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, what the DoD STEM is, you know, also in relation to DoD STEM ambassadors, and you know, what opportunities for are there for civilian as well as those in enlisted positions?
I'll let Eric take the first part and then I'll follow up.
I was hoping you'd jump in first, Aaron. So yeah, I think when we first got involved, I had the same questions. DoD, like, I'm not in the military. We work with teachers and students, and we quickly came to find out that, you know, some of the facts you'll actually see on the DoD STEM website, they employ the most scientists and engineers across all federal agencies. I think 300,000 or so scientists, engineers, or civilian engineers are out there at labs, dozens and dozens and dozens, maybe even hundreds of labs around the country doing some cutting edge scientific research, right? And I think for the DoD, like Darren was saying, it is a matter for them of national security, but you know, for them, a student in STEM is a win. Because if they go on to a career at Amazon or a new startup company we haven't heard of yet, that's a win for you know, the country and for our communities. But if they happen to matriculate into the DoD STEM world and work at a research lab outside Chicago, that's another win, right? I mean, so for them, it's really building the STEM pipeline, because they require the best and the brightest employees, but if students are going into STEM, that's a win for them. And so for them, it's all about access, opportunity, and outreach.
And I'll piggyback on that. Yes, there are opportunities to work within the DoD as a civilian, not necessarily military. But when you think about the Department of Defense, they contract with Amazon and Microsoft. Mm-hmm. They contract with Google. They do a lot of work. Northrop Grumman. There are a lot of companies out there that support the Department of Defense that are not defense contractors. They are companies. There are a lot of small businesses that do work with the Department of Defense. Years ago, in my younger years, a friend of mine and I worked on setting up computers pre-internet for one of the Navy bases. So the Department of Defense has a vested interest in the STEM workforce, not just for their own needs, but also just the innovations, because the innovations that happen in the civilian world can also benefit the Department of Defense. And the other thing is, like at Carter Rock, when we went to visit, there was one uniformed personnel and 3,000 civilians that were working there. So there's lots of opportunities for kids and young people to participate. I'm a mentor for Cyber Patriot, and it's one of the out of the Air Force, their STEM group, and it's high school students learning about cybersecurity. They've been a mentor for eCyber Mission, which comes out of the Army, and it's kids in classrooms really coming up with really cool projects, and they work with professionals and academic folks around the country to help them in building their project. So it's more than just the Department of Defense and military. It really is an investment by the federal government into our STEM academics and STEM workforce. In addition, we want kids to be STEM literate because they're going to be the policymakers in the future. You know, when you remember during the pandemic, when people were trying to figure out what science was and what science wasn't, well, part of that is making sure that we have a STEM literate workforce. When we're deciding on the routes of airplanes over communities, dropping fuel, all of that is part of having a STEM literate population.
Thank you so much for that and both your answers. This next question is for Eric, and I wonder if we can go back to the overview slide of what it means to be a DoD STEM ambassador and kind of the bullet points on that, if it's possible. Appreciate that. Eric, the question is, do you have to apply to a specific, thing just popped up my screen. Do you have to apply to a specific DoD STEM sponsor to become an ambassador? In other words, Darren is working with NCWIT as NCWIT's DoD STEM ambassador. Can you talk a little bit more about sort of the application process and what that looks like? And do you have to know about all these different organizations in order to apply?
Yeah, great question. So yeah, this program is a bit unique, I think, in this sense, in that each ambassador is sort of nominated by a different organization. So there is a single application that will be distributed. And so when you fill out the application, you will indicate which organization or organizations you would want to be your kind of host, right? So essentially, you do have to signal which organization I think you'd want to work with, but we want to be flexible and give you the opportunity to select more than one so that, because we understand that there's going to be a lot of quality applications. So I think by being here on this webinar, I think you already have a connection with NCWIT, right? But we've had teachers that will apply to be the Missile Defense Agency's STEM ambassador and not having known who the Missile Defense Agency is previously, and they were selected, right? So I think there are opportunities, even if you aren't deeply connected with one of the organizations in DoD STEM or DSEC, to still apply because your application will be evaluated just like everyone else's. So you don't have to have a special relationship necessarily with an organization to apply.
Thanks for that, Eric. Follow-up question on that. What's sort of a typical background for someone who is a DoD STEM ambassador?
Ooh, I don't think there is a typical background, to be quite honest. I think if you got to know the 25 other ambassadors, just like Darren, you'll see they all walks of life. And obviously STEM is important, right? Although, quite honestly, we have a elementary teacher this year who focuses a lot on reading and writing, but he coaches the robotics teams at this school, and he's a STEM ambassador this year. So, I think typically folks that go above and beyond kind of the kind of in class responsibilities. I think a lot of the folks are doing things like robotics clubs or doing things outside the classroom that kind of demonstrates their commitment to STEM in general, but really there is no typical applicant or awardee. You know, we have folks at community college level, at the high school level, inner city, rural, from all across the country. So I think if you're passionate, demonstrated interest in STEM and working with underrepresented populations of students or military connected students as well, I think you qualify.
Excellent. And one last question with the application. When will it open, or can you address, what the next, what you know, at least about the next cohort?
Yeah. So we anticipate opening the application in June. Typically the past couple of years, it's been opened in actually now or May, but a little bit delayed this year for reasons outside our control, but we hope it'll be open in mid to late June. In which case there'll be a probably a 3 to 4 week window to get applications in, and the program will again start this fall. So the best answer I give right now is mid to late June, but we cannot wait to get that application out.
Excellent. And we will be sure to share the application with those who are attending today, as well as that are registered once it is open, so that you can know if you're interested in applying to be a DoD STEM ambassador, you can go right to that application. Darren, another question for you. Can you tell us sort of how your participation as a STEM ambassador has really impacted your work with your students and sort of your day-to-day job, or has it?
Oh yes, it definitely has. One of the things of being a DoD STEM ambassador is you're in a community of folks. So there are a couple of folks that are near me, and we've connected. One of our DoD STEM ambassadors, Stan Lee, he's nearby in a local district to us, and so he's participated in some of our activities here. But you have this community of people that you can work with, and then the tie in to NCWIT. You know, being able to share information about some of the resources that are available. You know, I've had a number of conversations about inclusive computing, particularly here at the University of Southern California, where we have just launched a new school of advanced computing, and being able to have those conversations with the administration here and talking about, you know, how to be inclusive in computing. And the other thing is just being able to share the resources. Some of the member organizations in our STEM ecosystem are just small mom and pop community organizations. They're not teachers. They're just people in the community who use STEM as a way to engage kids to keep them out of trouble. And for them, being able to have access to resources for either from DoD STEM or from the Teach Engineering website of NCWIT, it gives them access to resources that they can trust. You know, if you go online and you Google, you know, lessons in magnetism now, you don't know what you're going to get. You don't know, you know, if it's going to be legitimate or not. And like, I'm from the pre-internet world, the pre-web world. And so, you know, we had to do experiments before we did lessons, but now you can just go online and grab a lesson, but you don't know if that lesson is true. I had to correct a colleague of mine who was trying to explain to kids that the toilets flush differently in the Southern Hemisphere because of the rotation of the Earth. He actually believed that, and I had to have a whole conversation with him. And I had to have that conversation in front of the kids because I can't have the kids believing that. And so part of, you know, being a DoD STEM ambassador is being able to share information and share resources. And again, like I said, the clout that comes with being a DoD STEM ambassador makes a difference when I'm talking to people about the work that we do and the importance of STEM. And again, the conversation has gone just from it's the right thing to do to engage kids of color and girls, and even going beyond the diversity bonus that, you know, the conversation of if you have more people at the table, you're more likely to have a better product. Even those things are important. For some people, that doesn't move the needle. For some people, you say, do you like your life? Do you like your lifestyle? Do you like your way of life? Well, to keep that going, you need people to come in and replace us during the silver tsunami. And for those that don't know what the silver tsunami is, it's people like me with my gray beard retiring. And after, you know, 40 years of being in STEM and in STEM education, my group is at the tail end of our careers, and we need millions of young people to pick up just to maintain what we've done, let alone do innovation. So it's been an enlightening conversation for a lot of people who aren't necessarily moved by diversity in terms of being the right thing or in terms of being the economic thing. They're moved in different ways, and being able to have a conversation and bring them into the conversation of sharing STEM has been important.
Wow, I really appreciate that. Thank you so much. I hadn't heard about the silver tsunami.
Those of us in the silver age know all about it.
I'm just hiding my silver. Yes. One last question. I think this is both for you, for Darren, and for Eric. You know, the DoD STEM ambassadors are brought in cohorts, so groups of people. I think you maybe mentioned, Eric, there were maybe 20 or 25. How do the cohorts work together? Or, you know, is there any kind of like community within each cohort, and then also each cohort with former cohorts? Like, what does that look like?
Yeah, I'll quickly share. So, you know, a lot of our work together is virtual. So, you know, it is a challenge to kind of create that community. But I think what we try to do, and Darren, please elaborate, is facilitate conversations and opportunities to work with people that you wouldn't normally work with, right? So, so I think for us, having the opportunity to have teachers de-siloed is a really kind of big component of the program to understand what the STEM landscape looks across the country and across different areas is really important. So we facilitate lots of conversations, lots of networking and resource sharing. We promote opportunities to work together. Like we had a group of a handful of ambassadors present together at the NSTA conference, for example, and we've had some others partner up as well at different conferences. And even the impact projects that we're just starting right now, we have some folks working together on some impact projects. So, you know, we do our best. And then the convening we had in DC, I think, was a really good opportunity to do a lot of that networking and building a community. But I don't know, Darren probably attests to it more than I can because he's in it.
And we also have a platform through, yeah. I'm not sure what RTI stands for anymore, but RTA Maze, where we can post to the community, former ambassador, ambassador alum, as well as current ambassador. And I've had conversations with ambassadors from prior cohorts who just reached out on LinkedIn. When I said I was a STEM ambassador, they reached out and we made connections. And so it's a badge of honor, and it's also a community of practice. So, you know, we here at USC, we talk about being a part of the Trojan family. Well, we have the same philosophy with the DoD STEM ambassadors. We're part of the DoD STEM ambassador family, knowing that, you know, if I reach out to another ambassador, they're going to do everything they can to support whatever work I'm doing, and likewise. And so we create this community of practice that will go on beyond our term, that will enable us to connect with one another and share some opportunities for partnerships. There are DoD STEM ambassadors that I've connected to, colleagues and friends in other states. It's very similar to the STEM ecosystem community of practice, where we are a loose connection of people who really are striving in the same direction toward enhancing opportunities in STEM. And the great thing about being an ambassador and being able to have those conversations with other people is you get to get out of your silo and out of your bubble of your work and have opportunities to do things on a larger scale and really start to change the face of what we do in STEM. When I first started in this field years and years and years ago, when people asked, like, what are your long-term goals? I said, I wanted to revolutionize STEM. And at the time, it was called science and engineering. It wasn't called STEM, but I wanted to revolutionize science and engineering in Southern California. And I think over my quarter century of being here that we've done that. And so my next goal is across the country. So not just here in Southern California, but across the country. And the way to do that is with people that are doing the same type of work. It is always great to be able to connect with somebody in another city, another community, somebody in a rural community and share ideas and ways in which we can work together.
And then Stephanie, I'm sorry, real quick, because I forgot to answer the question about the alumni. I'm glad Darren mentioned that. So we do invite, and we've had alumni come and speak to this current cohort about kind of the work that they've done, their impact projects, their blog posts. So we try to facilitate some of that cross cohort collaboration. And there's even some funding opportunities available, and we hope to keep that going. No promises, but certainly it's one of our goals is to provide more funding for alumni to continue some of the good work that they're doing. So beyond the year of the program, so. We're hopeful and excited to reward you for your time and effort past the year in the program.
It's fantastic. And from a sponsoring organization, it's been, you know, just an extreme pleasure to be working with Darren to learn more about his work, how we connect to DoD STEM, you know, how we can collaborate together, and also working with Eric in the same capacity. So it's really been a super win-win situation with this whole ambassador program and being part of the DoD STEM and the DSEC community. So highly encourage you, those that are here today and also those that watch the recording later, to really think about this particular opportunity, you know, if it fits with your career goals, or even if you're not sure, encourage you to apply and just find out more. So before we end today, I want to talk about a few more opportunities for everyone. And so if we could get the slide deck back up, that would be fantastic. NCWIT has lots of different resources that individuals can use to really work with their students with respect to computer science, technology, and STEM more broadly. And one of those resources is the Aspire IT Toolkit. This is a toolkit that if you are doing a computing or STEM-related activity and you wanted to think about ways that you could make it more inclusive, ways that you could really broaden participation, you can use this toolkit to help inform different ways to lift up your after school STEM club or coding camp or things like that. And for a short time, we are offering a $500 stipend if you are to evaluate that program and give us feedback on it. And Marlon, I'm so glad that you did that program and that you thought it was wonderful. So thank you. You can apply for this by going to the Aspire IT Toolkit site, and maybe we can get that into the chat for a direct link. Experiences need to be completed by July 14th. So if you already have something lined up for the summer and you want to take a look at the toolkit and see how you can implement it, you may get $500 from NCWIT for doing so. The next opportunity is an open invitation to check out our NCWIT Summit. The National Center for Women IT does an annual summit every year. This year it is in Kansas City. And we are bringing together change makers and thought leaders about talking about the future of tech. And so if you are interested in joining us, feel free to reach out to me directly. In fact, I will, maybe I can get my email in the chat there, Brittany, or I can do it myself in a minute. Reach out to me directly if you're interested. Encourage all memberships or those that are, you know, that are already members of NCWIT or the DSEC community to attend. There will also be some live streaming of our plenaries that will be online if you can't attend in person. And then finally, if you fill out the survey, either by using your phone and getting the QR code here, or you will also be sent something post this event by our evaluation team, and you fill out that survey, give us feedback on this event. If you are present here today, you will have a chance of a random drawing for a $100 gift card. So great chances for those who are participating today. If you're watching the recording, unfortunately, that's not part of the deal, but highly encourage you to come to some of our other future webinars, including we're doing one on the Smart Scholarship, something also through the DoD STEM for your students, as well as a couple of other webinars coming up like CS Plus Music, how music and computer science intersect. So hopefully you will join us for some of those future presentations. And for today, I just, again, want to extend my thanks to Darren Gray and Eric Moore for joining us to talk about the DoD STEM Ambassador Program. And I hope you've all learned something and will think about applying when the application opens. So thank you so much, and hope you all have a great evening.